and from China for Hindu pilgrims, and he was also a part of the first batch to go on the pilgrim route.
Possessing uncanny skills in lawyering, he has been instrumental in fighting numerous PILs and corruption cases in various courts of India.
It was Dr. Swamy who filed a case in Supreme Court against the EVM used in elections. The Election Commission has now conceded to his suggestion to give paper printout which can be stored and counted in case of dispute in EVM records.
With keen interest in economics, he is a published author of several books, research papers and journals on economic growth, reforms and policy. Part of many economic reforms in India, he holds a prime position in the refinement of Indian economy.
Dr. Swamy is the man behind implementation of market-based liberalized economic reforms in the country, as he strongly advocated against socialist economist policies.
Without any further ado, we take immense pleasure and gratitude in welcoming senior leader of BJP, six-term member of parliament and president of Virat Hindustan Sangam, Dr. Subramanian Swamy on stage.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here to see the Bits Pilani at Hyderabad. I've been to Bits at Pilani also. And I must say the infrastructure here is far superior to the one I saw in Pilani. I've been asked to speak on the Indian economy and with special focus on the future. But first of all, I find that the word economics is grossly misused. Even a chartered accountant is nowadays called an economist. People only who know buying and selling, they think they are economists. But economics is a science. It's been now elevated to the status of being awarded a Nobel Prize, which was originally started by Nobel for the purpose of science. And there were long years of debate, and finally, in 1970, the first Nobel Prize was given. And the first Nobel Prize was given to one of my teachers, Paul Samuelson, with whom I was a joint author. And the second year it was given to Professor Simon Kuznets, who was my thesis advisor. So, and what I learned from them and what I jointly researched with them showed me that economics is a very complex subject. And you should know the difference between microeconomics and macroeconomics. Economic policy for a country is macroeconomics. Economics of two people bilaterally bargaining and buying and selling, that's microeconomics. And the laws that you derive from microeconomics are not the laws which necessarily apply in macroeconomics. And that's why many governments which without economists as finance ministers, they make mistakes because they don't know the after effects, the scope of macroeconomics. Give you the example of my quarrel, or rather my demand that Raghuram Rajan should be removed from the governorship of Reserve Bank and sent back to America. A lot of people were very angry with me and they tried to malign me and twist my remarks, etc. And especially society ladies, because they said he looked better, more handsome than any other previous governor, as if that was a qualification. But the fact of the matter is he propagated the thesis that if you raise interest rates, there's a contraction in the money supply and therefore there is reduction of inflation. So for the sake of inflation, he kept on raising the interest rate. And it was a mischievous thing because he had an agenda which the Prime Minister and others found out later after much propagation by me. But it was bad economics also. When you raise the interest rate, the cost of capital for investment also goes up. And there are many, many factories which work on the borderline, the small and medium industries, which take loans that they work at almost at a very, very cutthroat level. So when you raise the interest rate, what happens is that these small and medium industries start closing down, as has happened in India the last 4 years, and unemployment increases. So you may control inflation, but that doesn't mean that you are not affecting unemployment. You are affecting unemployment and you are increasing it. It's like a doctor saying to somebody that, you see, I found it very difficult to reduce the temperature of my patient. So ultimately I decided to kill him because that was the only way to reduce temperature. So when a man dies, of course the temperature will come down. So in economics, what you do here has an effect somewhere else. The American Depression came because the American president didn't realize that. His economist told him that, you see, the wages by collective bargaining and trade unions has gone so high that people are not recruiting. So you must persuade, because an election year was coming. So they said you must persuade the unions to, at least till the elections are over, to reduce, agree to a cut in wages of 10%. So the president at that time, in the 1920s, he spoke to the unions agreed, and they cut wages by 10%. And what happened? Unemployment increased. So the president was perplexed, he called back the economist had no idea. And then the new economic theory of, the macroeconomic theory of economics came. Because when you cut wages of labor, purchasing power also goes down. And purchasing power goes down, then the demand also goes down. And if demand goes down, then obviously there'll be a recession. And therefore, the companies will start folding up because they're making losses. So that's how the depression came. And then the new subject of economics came. So in India, you must remember, we have, when you talk about policy, don't talk about buying and selling prices, why stock prices are going up. These have got nothing to do with the general economic policy. General economic policy consists of four clear parts: your objective, second, your priorities, third, your strategy for achieving those priorities, and four, the resource mobilization methods. I've advocated abolition of income tax. People say, oh, where will you get the resources from? Oh, there are many areas of getting resources from. When I got in the Supreme Court to cancel all the 2G spectrum license and an order that they should not be given on a first come first served basis, but must be auctioned. The auction brought you in the very first year for 2G. It brought you 4 lakh crore rupees. And that was equal to the income tax revenue. So already you have a methodology. If you tomorrow auction the coal blocks, which have not been so far done, then you will get 11 lakh crores. And if you go and get all the money that is abroad, that's 120 lakh crores. Now politicians don't like my saying this because many of them have got accounts. So they say some other method. But 120 lakh crores is what? It is if 4 lakh crores is your income tax revenue, then 120 lakhs is what? 30 times. Am I right? No, it's more than that. It's 8 times. So 120 is, no, excuse me, it is 3 times. And 3 times, 4 lakh multiplied by 3, 30 times, excuse me. Finally, but my arithmetic, too much, when you do too much algebra, you forget, you know, arithmetic. Anyway, the fact of the matter is there's no shortage of resources in India. It's a question of how you raise it. For that, you have to be an economist. So therefore, there are resources are not in short supply in India. So if tomorrow India wants to become a developed country, by the way, what is the Indian position today in GDP in the world? I was shocked when Mr. Venkaiah Naidu, as the chairman of the Rajya Sabha, in his speech said that we are the 6th largest GDP. I interrupted him. I said, "Go, got it wrong." He said, "Why?" I said, it is 3rd largest, United States, China, India. But they kept on saying because the IMF says it is 6 times. Why? Because the IMF evaluates our GDP, which is given to them by our country's Central Statistical Organization in rupees. They convert it to dollars by dividing it by the exchange rate between the dollar and the rupee. So exchange rate is 10 rupees, you get one answer. If the exchange rate is 75 rupees as it's now, you get another answer. You get a smaller answer. So the United Nations had decided after my paper, joint paper with Paul Samuelson on index number theory, that GDP will be evaluated for comparison, not by exchange rates which keep fluctuating, but by the price of one country applied to all countries uniformly. So if you are comparing America and India, American prices will be used to evaluate Indian production. Haircut. What is the price of haircut in America of equal quality? It will be 30, 40 times. So therefore, our value of our production will be higher when you use the American prices. And if you use what is called as the purchasing power parity rate, the Indian GDP turns out to be number three. And it's only a matter of time. I think the next 10 years will be number two. And then we'll have a direct contest with the United States. Now, what do we need for India to become a developed country in the next 20, 30 years? Do we have it in us to become? Problem with Indians, we all suffer from inferiority complex, which has been put into us in our brain by the British, and we think we can't do anything. I remember the time when Jawaharlal Nehru implemented the Soviet economic model. And then for 40 years, the Soviet economic model was the one that was being used in India. 5-year plans and all that. I came back from Harvard, started teaching at IIT. And then I said, if India wants to really grow at more than 3.5% per year, it must give up the Soviet system and adopt the market system. And I wrote a book on it. I don't know what happened. Mrs. Gandhi got irritated. And she, in parliament, took out my book and started reading, said, Professor of IIT, such people are there in IIT who are saying things about our government. I wasn't saying anything about the government, I was saying about the Soviet system. And I was proposing an alternative system. But our director got so chicken with that remark of Indira Gandhi, that the next day he sent me a letter at 5:15 that effective from 5 o'clock, you're no more professor of IIT. So I went and told him, how can you remove a person who's a full professor like this? He says, I got orders from the top, you go and fight in court. I did fight in court. It took me 22 years to win. And then the IIT wrote me a letter, please come and resume your duties. I came back and I became professor of IIT again in 1991, but for only one day. I said, I don't want to be a professor at IIT after seeing the quality of you people who have no brains. No, you have no, you may have brains, but you don't have. And I asked for my salary of last 22 years. At 18% interest. And I'm going to get it very soon. It will be a couple of crores, so I'll get a lot of good pocket money. So, without doing any work for the IIT, they have to pay for it. Now, the issue is, of course, I had no other place I could be getting a job. No other place was ready to give me a job, all afraid of Indira Gandhi. So I entered politics, I became a Raj Sabha member. After that, the emergency came where I played a major role. So I became Lok Sabha MP. And after I became Lok Sabha MP, Morarji Desai became Prime Minister. He asked me one day, is it a fact that you were dismissed from IIT? I said, yes. He said, I have decided to appoint you as the member of the Board of Governors of IIT. So I said, how can I sit with those people who passed a resolution to dismiss me? He said, no problem, I've dismissed all of them already. So those who fight, remember, you, in the most unexpected moment, you will get your reward. I never thought this would happen in our country. It happened. This country has got a lot of potential. I also later became the chair, a member of the IIT Council of all IITs. And therefore, I'm saying to you today that my views at that time was that 3.5% per year is too little for India. We must have 10% growth rate. How do we have 10% growth rate? Even today, 7-8% is not enough. You must have 10% growth rate. And 10% growth rate, you need a different specific policies. For that, you have to understand the dynamics economics. The dynamics of economics is that the growth rate is decided by two variables. One is called innovation, and the other is called the level of inputs of capital and labor. So both these separately have to be seen. Just by having more labor, more capital, like we say, oh, foreign investment. What happens is, if you have a graph of capital on this side and labor on this side, then the production function is a curve like that. The more capital and more labor, the more production, but less and less in incremental, which we call as the law of diminishing returns. So it tapers off. And then you can't raise the growth rate anymore. So if you want to go to a higher growth rate, you have to go to a higher curve. You have to jump to a higher curve. And that jump is called innovation. For example, Britain was a poor country, but then they looted our money, and then they financed research, and they discovered they invented the locomotive, then the Bessemer steel blast furnace. So that brought industrial evolution, a step in the growth rate, big step. The Americans came, they brought in integrated production systems. Later on, they brought in jet engines, they brought in fax machines, and finally, the end of the last century, they brought in internet, which has reduced transaction cost to a bare minimum, and the speed of communication to be instantaneous, the speed of light. So, therefore, every innovation that was brought in raised the productivity of the inputs, and the inputs are only two, capital and labor. But the productivity of its use is determined by innovations. And therefore, today in our country, can we make innovations? Of course, very bright people. We have a long history. We discovered calculus long before anybody did. Decimal point, zero, so many things, surgery. But in between, these innovations came and we were left behind. But today, our bright students, when they go abroad, they do very well. Somebody is head of Google, somebody is head of Microsoft, somebody is this Surgeon General. You know, all kinds of important positions where you need brains, the Indians are present. The Indians in my class were the brightest, but all Indians have one failing. They're not risk takers. They're risk averters. I used to ask my students in class, after my class was over and the grades were given, I said, now what kind of career are you going to adopt or take? A career where you take risks like Bill Gates or the man who invented the Apple equipment, Steve Jobs. Are you going to take a risk, or you're going to go for a job where the increment is every year, and it goes on and on till you retire, then you get a fat gratuity and provident fund and all, buy a house and watch television. And if you are in America, you sit in the park and feed the pigeons. That's the kind of life people lead. And most Indians are doing that. Why? Because they had a job which was steady, you couldn't be terminated easily, and your salary increased slowly every year. So in the class, I asked them, the Americans would ask me, what's the probability of becoming Bill Gates? But the Indians will say, no, no, the second job is what you want. I'm sure all of you will also be now thinking of joining some firm and becoming a business executive. That's what I was experienced when I went to IIM and asked them, what will you do after getting an MBA? They said, oh, we'll look for some multinational corporation and get a job. Some of them said that our dowry will be highest if we join a foreign company. So this is the kind of risk aversion that takes place. Not start my own company. Not I will do some startup. I will fail, but I will try again. That spirit is not there in India just now. It has to be inculcated. Things are much better with the present generation than the previous day. So if our Indians, with all their brains, become innovators, this country will boom. And simple applications. This Karnataka and Tamil Nadu are all fighting about this Kaveri. So one day to trap me, some DMK reporters or newspaper asked me, what is your stand on the Kaveri issue? Now, if I supported Karnataka, they would say I'm anti-Tamil. And if I supported the Tamils, they were Karnataka, some Chuvalligar or somebody will come and attack me. So they wanted to trap me. So I said, first you tell me, do you want Kaveri water or you want water? So if you want water, I can get you water. So they asked me, how can you get water? There's nothing in the Kaveri River. Where will you get the water from? I said, by desalination of seawater. The Kalpakkam nuclear project, they are giving water 24 hours a day to their employees by desalinating seawater. In Jamnagar, the Reliance company for polyester, they were told by the Jamnagar municipality, we can't give you water. So they said, okay, we'll put a desalination plant. They put it, and now they produce so much water that they are selling it to the Jamnagar municipality. So this is the way. Same thing, 60% of the world's thorium is in the sands of India. I discovered this when I saw one day in the newspapers, somebody has been arrested for sand smuggling in Tamil Nadu. I said, must be mad, why would anybody smuggle sand? It's freely available, just pick it up. But then I found out that India's sand, particularly in the coast of Tamil Nadu and Kerala, they have monazite which can be converted to thorium and thorium to uranium. And uranium in another 25, 30 years is going to be exhausted. The Americans already started doing research on thorium, how to convert thorium into U-233 and then onto a reactor usable uranium. But in our country, in 1952, Homi Bhabha started the research. There were three stages to go through. We finished two stages. When we were about to embark on the third stage, the Americans signed the atomic energy deal with us, and Manmohan Singh cancelled all further research on thorium. But if thorium is used, you will have power for not only every house, you can give it free. Like some countries where they're supply, they give free. For example, Qatar, they give gas free. You can use cooking gas in that country free because there's so much gas is produced. So much electricity will produce, you can give it to your neighbors. But we need this innovation. Hydrogen fuel cells for automobiles, that's coming in the future. Electric cars have already come, but hydrogen fuel cells will be much more efficient, much more pollution free. Nobody's working on it. And if you do that and make it effective, then you will find that nobody will be buying crude oil. And what will the poor Arabs do? They'll go back to their tents and their camels. They'll be no more be able to build these fancy buildings. India is full of potential. And we have the material for it. Because the demographic dividend, as it's called. It's not a dividend yet, but potential dividend. Our population of age 35 and below, which is the age when they do the maximum amount of potential for research, is 70%. 70% of our population is below the age of 35. Average age of Indian is 26. What's the average age of Chinese? 35. Because of their one child per family policy. Americans 37, Europeans 46 years old, and the Japanese 50. These are all aging populations. And they're having a pension bomb because few people are coming into the labor force, large number of people are going out of it, and also living longer. And they're not able to pay the pension. When there were large numbers of people coming into the labor force, and fewer people were going out to the labor force in the retirement and dying much more quickly. That time, they had plenty of money. So Provident Fund, all these things, gave a huge amount of money to the state to pay pension without any difficulty. But the situation has changed. But we have this bonanza, which I call as the demographic potential dividend. And we should use it. We should build many more universities. We have just, I think, 400 or 500 universities. We should have 2,000 universities. What's the difficulty in building a university? There are plenty of people. You should have training schools and colleges so new professors come. Professors should give a very decent salary and so that they are attracted. People are now going to companies. And people are not going to the army today, for example, because companies pay much better. So we have to, therefore, have that kind of policy. And therefore, you make the use of capital more efficient. Indian households produce for the country 35% of your GDP as savings. No other country in the world, the households save so much. Americans save on -2% because they're using credit cards. They don't save at all. They're so secure. But our people are insecure, so the women of our country have been saving, and today the household saving is 35% of GDP. And if 35% of GDP is efficiently used, you will not get 3.5% per year, which we, in the inefficient Soviet system we had, but you'll get 10% growth rate, the difficulty. And that is what should be our target. How to generate people to save more. So I said, abolish income tax. And everybody shocked, where will the resources come from? What do you mean, your option spectrum? Say, no, no, spectrum only once you can do. I said, yes, but 2G, then 3G, then 4G, then 5G. One day I asked Manmohan Singh, do you know what 2G is? He said, yes, Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi. That is the ignorance in our country of a highly educated man like Manmohan Singh, a good friend of mine. Then I told him G stands for generation. And that means the cyclic movement of the airwaves. So there is unlimited scope. It goes to 5G, 6G, already 5G is on the market, coming to the market soon. So all these available, the potential of India is so enormous that we can become a developed country, overtake China, which is not based on innovations at all. It is based on switch markets and getting semi-processed goods from East Asia and selling it to the West after processing it. That kind of thing can't last long, but ours will last long, and we can overtake China, and then the biggest innovator in the world today, the United States, will face a challenge from me. Why do you think that Trump is canceling your visas? Because he understands that if these Indians start going back to India and they get a good climate there to do innovations, then they'll become a challenge to India, to America. So that's why he's doing this thing on this. Otherwise, they are benefiting by our scientists, scholars going at just and accepting a lower wage than the American white Americans. But he's putting a block on it, because he sees the long-term threat of it. So today, have hope. This country is capable of becoming a developed country by 2050. It is capable of overtaking China in the next 10 years. It can be a challenge by 2040 with the Americans, and then become the world's most developed country by 2050. That potential we have. But we need our people to be adventurous. We need our people to be risk takers. And we must see that we are all one in terms of utilizing our abilities. And for that, gender equality is also important. It has always been important in our society from thousands and thousands of years. I tell people that, see, Brahma's cabinet, all the important portfolios are with women. Finance is with Lakshmi. Education is with Saraswati. Defense is with Durga. What the men have got? Nothing. So somebody told me, men have got information broadcasting for Narad Muni. We have always treated women as equal. Physically, they may not be, in physical strength, they may not be, but in mind strength, they are. You see that Mahabharata war was because of one woman being dishonored. The destruction of the Lanka Empire was because of the kidnapping of one woman. There have been galore stories. Women have been warriors. Rani Jhansi, everybody knows. But in Karnataka, Rani Chennamma, nobody knows, because their history is not taught properly. So therefore, this gender equality, this promotion of adventure in life to try and find new ways of solving the problems, these kinds of attitudes come, their country doesn't lack resources, we will be a developed country soon. Of course, in the next 10 years, if you want to do it, you need a better finance minister than you got today. And I can recommend some names also. So the country is not short of good policies, but the people in authority must understand that. And that is why I think that this, all of you, the future generations, you have a very, very bright future. And I'm happy that this country is today where it has become, and it is going to go in the next 10 years even further. Thank you very much.
you yet again, Vince Pilani, all of you wonderful audiences, and above all, Dr. Swamy. It's a privilege of a different order to be here and getting an opportunity to ask you questions. It's also like being asked to come and box with Mike Tyson, but then the risk that he spoke of, I have taken it in being next to him with a list of questions. How many of you in the audience like Subhash Chandra Bose? One of the most fascinating things about about Subhash Chandra Bose was he was put under house arrest in Kolkata, and he managed to escape right under the eyes of the British. And from Afghanistan, went to Germany, went to Japan, served the Indian National Army, and brought freedom before August 15, 1947 on the soil of India. How many of you think I told you this story because this gentleman next to me disappeared when all of Indian police and intelligence was watching out for him during emergency? He disappeared. Srimati Indira Gandhi was obviously panicking, wondering where on earth is he, and what does he do? He comes into the parliament where police cannot enter, gives a statement, asks a question, and then disappears again and is next seen in England, where he is leading global opinion against emergency. My question to you, Dr. Swamy, is, and you've spoken about taking a risk, what drives a person and how do you overcome fear to do something so extraordinarily brave for a cause, for a society, for a country?
I can give a short answer, but if you want a thorough answer, you should read Bhagavad Gita. Where Arjuna refuses to fight. And the shlokas which are there of Krishna, they say what I will say in short. If you are satisfied that you are doing whatever you are doing is to the best of your ability, and you are not, you work for a goal, but you don't care whether you get it or you don't get it. Because Krishna says, you have freedom of action, but not the right to the fruit of that action, that I decide according to your karmas. So if you believe that, then you'll never be in stress. Stress comes because, oh, what will happen? What will people think if I fail, if I don't do well, if I lose an election? This kind of thing, you see. That fear that you begin to lose even before you started the fight, that is what is keeping Indians back. Do it, say yes, I'm doing to the best of my ability and circumstance, but if the results don't come in my favor, I don't mind. Because it is Krishna at fault, not at me, I'm at fault. I have done my best, he is not doing his best. That way, if you have that, then stress goes away. And today the American corporate sector has been taught this because they had such a large number of heart attacks in the age of 45. That they examined that it was this fear of the future. What will happen in the future? So that is the thing. Our country has been taught to be fearful of the future by the British. And this whole Babu education, as it was called in those days, is to say that you are not equal to the best in the country, in the world. That thing must go. You can be totally free of fear if you are not afraid of the future. You say, I've done it, this is my choice, and I'll do my best. If I don't succeed, I don't mind, I'll try again. And most of the time, people who have failed 4 or 5 times have always succeeded the 5th time. The example is of Abraham Lincoln. He lost 6 elections in a row. And the 6th one, he became the president of the United States, and he became today regarded as the most best president of the United States. That is the secret.
So how many of you failed once in the last 2 months, 2 times, 3 times, hands? Are you ready to keep doing it? As Dr. Swamy says, till you get success?
Yes!
Excellent, Dr. Swamy. This agenda of abolishing income tax is something we've consistently tried to bring to Indian mainstream since 1991, since I've been following you.
Yeah.
What is the chance of it becoming possible next year? One. Did you have a better chance, or did you feel any prime minister felt it made sense politically? Would you like to change this to a more politically appealing program by saying initially we should abolish income tax for women or Dalits and then incrementally get it at all?
See, Indians are very clever. If I say income tax should be abolished for women, then men will all create accounts so that they are sitting at home and the women are doing all the work.
Which is good.
So, it's a very dangerous thing. In the emergency, Mrs. Gandhi said nobody can have more than two children. So what did those who had three children do? They declared two and one was undeclared. So they had black children and white children, like black money and white money. Indians are too intelligent. Make it straightforward. No. Full stop. Abolishing. Put a lock on the income tax office. Then you'll see the country will be thrilled and do it. I have spoken to the Prime Minister, and the Prime Minister is neutral about it. He thinks that it can be done. But our Prime Minister may be in favor, but our Finance Minister is not. Because
I'll come to you.
He's a lawyer.
Minister in the Modi government in a way.
No, see, lawyers want more and more complicated things, because then you will come running to them, please solve this problem. An economist will make it simpler and simpler, but the lawyer will make it more complicated.
Since you've already said the BJP government has failed to meet the aspirations of people
on
2014 level in economic terms.
Say that first.
In economic terms, BJP government has let down the people of India vis-a-vis the aspirations. And if you had the opportunity and Mr. Modi asked you to take your good friend Mr. Arun Jaitley's job next year, what are the two things or three things you would do which were not done in this term, which could help us with a 10% growth rate and not just jobs, but bright opportunities for people of this demographic grouping?
I will do three things. Abolish income tax, to raise the interest on fixed deposit to 9% and reduce the interest on loans to 9%. They present, what is called as the bank rate is 12% and the market you get for 18%. But you reduce it to. And that's very important, because that's the only way you can produce growth. I remember when I was minister in commerce in the 90s, that time the Walmart came to see me saying that I hear from the Prime Minister you're opposing us coming in. I said, yes. He said, but we thought you were a market economy man, and I'd be surprised. I said, no, I am a market economy man, but the thing is that the competition between Walmart and our traders should be on a level playing field. He said, why is it not level playing? I said, you get loans in your country at 2% interest, and you come here and take employ our cheap labor, whose wage rate will go up. What will happen to our traders? They will be hit both ways. They will have to get loans at 12%, 18%, etc. And they'll have to pay now a higher price for the labor that they employ. So it's not a level playing field. Then said, how can this be solved? I said, you allow our companies to go and build roads and houses and all in America and take our labor there for that work. He said, no, that would be an immigration problem. I said, well, that's your problem, because you want your capital to come here and take advantage of our labor, but you don't want our labor to go there and take advantage of your capital. So this can't go on. And that's the reason why I'm saying that this interest rate raising is the most criminal thing to do in India. Because people are struggling to pay back their loans, you see. So lower the interest rate to 9%, raise the fixed deposit rate to 9%, abolish income tax. Tomorrow you'll see the economy will be booming.
Ladies and gentlemen, you will never hear anybody say it like this, and I've heard him say it since 1991, at least on income tax. I'd like to take your attention to a different aspect altogether. I think it's 4 decades since Mao passed away, and you were the first Indian to make contact and talk to the Chinese.
Yes.
You saw China is going to change and become what it is much before, not just Indians, but intellectuals across the world did. Today, at an approximate 80 trillion GDP, we are about 3.5%. If you take Hong Kong and China together, they almost are 14% of. What are the three things or two things you have seen different about China and Chinese people, especially Chinese youngsters or the Chinese government, which makes them seem far more formidable or far more difficult as a competition or rival, militarily, economically, in terms of quality of a product compared to India? And what do you think we need to do culturally to transform this mindset of slavery to be able to take on the rest of the people in the world on equal terms?
Three things that China did. You see, in 1980, the Chinese and Indian economy was on par because both were following the Soviet model and they produced the same level of growth of 3.5% per year. After Deng Xiaoping came, he brought in such these modernizations that the economy began to move, boom. And we continued with the Soviet system till 1990, till the Soviet Union itself had collapsed. Now, the three things they did is, one, they told East Asian countries, like Japan, Taiwan, Philippines, etc., Singapore, that you are producing these advanced equipment like laptops and computers, radio, cell phones, blah, blah, etc., and sending it to America, but your labor high costs are so high. What you do is you semi-process these things, send it, but we will buy it. And in Shenzhen and other places, we will add the value to it. Like, for instance, Lenovo is written made in China, but it's not made in China. The fundamentals are made in Taiwan. So that basic circuit comes to China. They put in the keyboards, they put in the glass case, etc., the screen, and then they put the stamp made in China and export it to the West. So import semi-processed goods from East Asia and add value to it and complete the processing, and then send it at a much higher price to Europe and America, and have good relations with America and Europe so that they give you most favored nation clause and so on. That's the third part. So what this did was that they earned a huge amount. If you look at the Chinese trade data, they have negative trade, balance of trade with East Asia, but they have a huge positive balance of trade with America and Europe. So that's first thing that they did. Second thing they did was we can't do because we are a democracy. They brought their agricultural laborers and made them work 18 hours and so on in very hard conditions. So this is the second thing they did. And the third thing is they used their influence to see that their other countries' markets are open. And they, since it's a communist country, they were able to do things which a democratic country can't do. Take, for instance, Hambantota in Sri Lanka. Rajapaksa was president. He offered it to India. It was UPA government. Said, please build this port for us. So Manmohan Singh was the prime minister. He asked Sonia Gandhi, and because he has to ask her. So she said, let us ask Karunanidhi. And Karunanidhi said, no, he's a killer of Tamils. How can we do this? Blah, blah, blah. We did not agree. Then the Chinese came to them, said, why you want the Indians to build and charge you for it? And you have to pay for it. We'll do it free for you. Now, what do you think that the Sri Lankans would do? They gave it. After that, we have been screaming away, oh, the Chinese have come, Chinese. Same thing happened in Maldives also. So, I am saying this, that this is one of the things they did. What we should do, we should improve our infrastructure, because I asked the Japanese one day, why don't you send it through India? They said, you've got a lousy infrastructure. There are so many stops you have to do, so many bribery you have to do. In China, you have to bribe only one man, and then everything follows suit. But in India, you have to bribe all the way down to the chaprasi, you see. So, therefore, there's the ease of doing business, so to speak. And then, you see, your ships take, so many days to turn around. Not less than 7 days. But in Singapore, they turn around the ship in 7 hours. So, why should we come when the Chinese are doing it much more efficiently? So, this is the difference that is there. Yes, but not on my party, you must talk about the other party.
I thought your party was not corrupt at all.
I know better.
So my question is this. You have fought with Indira Gandhi during emergency. You say, and I'll come to it in a bit later, you've stopped Sonia Gandhi from being
Prime Minister.
Prime Ministership and put pressure on them. I don't know, this is what he says. I am not saying. I'll just take this version. And you have fought with Arun Jaitley when your own government is in power. You have perfected the art of saying whatever you want and getting away with murder. But at this point of time, you have to say something you have never said before in your life. Have you been humbled by a fellow Tamilian, given his influence, even when he's in opposition, that you are almost to the point of saying, I'll withdraw cases? Has P. Chidambaram proved to be a tougher neck to crack than Sonia Gandhi, Rahul Gandhi, Indira Gandhi, Jayalalitha, everybody put together?
Well, what happened in the last 2 months is very tragic. The CBI director, Mr. Alok Verma, was earlier Commissioner of Police Delhi. And he was very, very upright. The commissioner before him was somebody called Basi or something like that. In the Sunanda murder case, the previous police administration tried to rub out the evidence and tried to make it out to be a natural death. And fortunately, the All India Medical Institute forensic science chairman and professor, Sudhir Gupta, he did the autopsy or the postmortem, and he said, no, it's an unnatural death. So they by then our government came, and I made the thing, and Mr. Verma came, and he in fact set up a vigilance inquiry as to how this data was destroyed. So from that time, a lot of people were against him. This guy is not a team player. Now, when his appointment came, the Prime Minister chose him because of this fearlessness. And in the appointments committee of the cabinet, the Congress representative is also represented. This is a Supreme Court order of 1996. And Karri, his name is. He wrote an 8-page letter against Mr. Verma, saying he is a totally undesirable person, he's this, he's that, and he will oppose it. But he was outvoted. It was 2-1. The Prime Minister, Home Minister, and Mr. Karri. Now, today the Congress Party is all praising Mr. Verma, which is very unusual. But the fact is that this man was going so fast on Mr. Chidambaram's cases and many other cases that he had to be stopped. So the bureaucracy was the one that the Congress Party actually used. And I think that one or two people of our party also were complicit, but I'll not name them just now. Next time when you call me, I will. But they put up a man as his number two, despite his having 7-8 corruption cases against him. And the idea was then to create such a situation that Mr. Verma, who was to retire in February, himself in disgust goes and leaves. But he didn't. He started fighting. So he, in fact, had brought these cases against Mr. Astana, as it's called, before the government. Now, the Supreme Court is going to consider all this unobjectively. And I would be very apprehensive how it will go, because I don't want my party to be damaged. You see, some order, they pass some strictures, because we have come on the, to power on the plank of corruption. So therefore, I thought it was my duty to inform the Prime Minister, and that only I could do public by going public, because privately I was not getting the appointment. That time he was to come to Japan, he's now gone to Japan. He had so many engagements, and there's no point in talking to him on the telephone on this. So I went public and said, if he's removed, then I understand. And then there's another officer called Rajeshwar in the Enforcement Directorate, who was targeted by Chidambaram earlier. And then our government is also targeting him. That is the Finance Secretary, Joint Secretary of this. So I felt that there's no way to save these people. So I said that if this is happens, then I will go to the courts and say, I'm no more interested in fighting corruption, I'm withdrawing my cases. That caught the attention of the Prime Minister. And then I have sent a message that nothing of the kind will happen. And then in the meantime, Mr. Verma has gone to the court. Supreme Court has now said that the CVC will conduct the inquiry, but it will be supervised by the Supreme Court. Now, CVC was originally set up for not having any supervision, but that they would supervise the CBI. Now, it's a devaluation of the CVC. And if in case the court decides that Mr. Verma should be reinstated, it will be a big setback for us.
Talking about courts, I'd like you to reflect, and this question is directed to that part of you who has been like a statesman for this judicial pillar of our democracy. What has hurt Indian judiciary more? Srimati Indira Gandhi's attack, or the self-inflicted wound of five milords coming and giving a press conference on what seemed at one level administrative matters like who's the captain of the rooster, etc. So is the Supreme Court and the entire judiciary under greater attack today as revealed by that or during the emergency and subsequent?
First, I'll give you the short answer. No. It was much worse during Indira Gandhi's time. And why? She started first by removing superseding five judges and bringing Chandrachud, the father of the present judge, as Chief Justice. And that all those five judges resigned. Okay, that was because she felt that there should be a compliant judge. Earlier on, judges were giving excellent judgments. They were men of great caliber. So that was the first blow. Second blow was when when Mr. Chandrachud got passed or brought in, there was a judgment he had to give where he said that in the emergency, it is possible to kill somebody, but the state can kill somebody without a trial. So that the number two of him was Hansraj Khanna. And Hansraj Khanna, H.R. Khanna, he wrote a dissent judgment. And Mrs. Gandhi bypassed him also. So therefore, I'm saying to you that the confidence that if I say something, and then I'm losing the Chief Justiceship, that, you see, will completely destroy the judiciary. In our case, Mr. Gogoi was a member of that group, and yet we have made him Chief Justice. So it's a compliment to Mr. Narendra Modi that he did not waver on this, that this man will be too tough for me, and therefore I'll bypass and I'll appoint somebody else. So therefore, I don't think there is any comparison at all between BJP government and the previous governments.
I'll take you now to the gravest concern people have vis-a-vis your government by asking a first sub-question connecting judiciary and the agenda of Hindutva. Sabrimala verdict. Do you think by not asking the petitioners who they were, what their loci standi was vis-a-vis the petition in public interest, and to not considering the issue and case of the faith in Hinduism being a matter of the temple practice as opposed to the larger practice, etc., did the court make a mistake or was the judgment in error? And more importantly, if there is a verdict from any court in India, if somebody finds it's flawed, can they say courts have no role and my faith is superior to the point I will use force to defy it? And if so, what happens tomorrow? A very important case opens on a daily basis. If the Ram Janmabhoomi Babri Masjid verdict comes in favor of one community, what happens if the other community says Sabrimalai? In other words, the media has said, is Sabrimalai the BJP's Ayodhya in Kerala? I'm asking you the counter. What happens if people use the Sabrimalai modus of opposing a court verdict in the Ram Janmabhoomi movement in the coming days?
First of all, let me tell you that the judges have to go by the constitution. They can't take in some other factors into account. They may do it without telling any of us, but they're not supposed to. Now, the constitution says under Article 25 that everybody has a fundamental right to pray according to his faith. But it also says, but subject to reasonable restrictions imposed on that fundamental right on the basis of morality, on the basis of public health and public order. So you can't put restrictions on fundamental rights. It also says that no fundamental right shall violate another fundamental right. One fundamental right is that equality before the law. That includes men and women. That's Article 14. So, second restriction you can put is morality. So, the Supreme Court said, how does the biological difference between a woman and man, or a young woman and an old woman, be a factor in deciding who can enter, who cannot enter? On the basis that you say, Ayyappa will not be happy. That is the argument they gave. And within the framework of the Constitution, it was absolutely correct. However, when it came to implementation, our the fact that who were the petitioners, they did not bring it up. They should have brought it up. That the there are five, in Kerala, five important temples like Sabrimalai, Ayyappa temples. In four of them, this restriction is not there. It is only in this one. Why? Because I did some research and then I checked it with scientists, in Indian scientists in California, and they confirmed to me that originally it was felt that because of that terrain and the gravitational matrix, which are, you know, the gravitational pull varies, therefore it would have a genetic mutation for a woman who will be becoming pregnant after she comes and goes. So this should have been explained in the courts itself, and two, the chief minister should have told the Devasam board people as well as the people who came that you have got the right from the Supreme Court, but you are taking this risk. In my opinion, the women themselves would have opted not to go, and we could have harmonized this thing. Now, when you come to Ram Temple, there are two types of petitions there. the two petitions. One is mine exclusively. I'll tell you what that is in a minute. But in Allahabad High Court, when the matter was argued, the Muslim party did not argue that our masjid has been demolished and therefore it should be given back to us, the land should be given to us. They did not argue that. They argued that Babur had captured this land and we are his descendants and therefore this property belongs to the Sunni Waqf Board. The Hindu parties were, one was Ram Janmabhoomi Nyas and the other was some akhada, Nirmohi akhada. They argued that the temple that was existing, we were the trustees. Because in our concept, temple cannot be owned by anybody but the God who is there. So, this Allahabad High Court dismissed the Muslim Sunni Babur's prayer and said, no, you don't enjoy any title just because Babur forcibly occupied some land. And they have come an appeal against that. Even in the Supreme Court, they are not asking that. I brought in a petition to say that this claim for property is an ordinary right. But I have a fundamental right. That faith tells me Ram was born in a particular spot. And therefore, I have a fundamental right under Article 25 to have the access to pray there. And therefore, a temple should be built. And these people's right is an inferior right to my superior right, a fundamental right. So the Congress lawyers, what they did was, they said he's relying on a 1994 judgment of the Supreme Court where he said that masjid is not an essential part of Islamic religion. It can be destructed, it can be shifted. In Arab countries, they are doing it, all that. So they wanted review of that. And they spent 4 months on that. And now the Supreme Court has upheld the 1994, so there should be no difficulty since both parties are participating. The Supreme Court in this day-to-day hearing dismisses this, considers my prayer first, and then afterwards these people's prayers. But if they consider these people's property wala's prayer first, it will go on for a very long time. Mine will not take more than 1 month because my respondents are not the Muslim parties but the government of India and the UP government. So I'm saying this, if they don't settle this, then we have under the law and under the constitution an alternative, and that is to bring an ordinance and take over that and hand it over for building of the temple. And I would advise our government to use that.
Can you check the political premise on which Dr. Swamy has predicted the comeback of Mr. Narendra Modi? Just all of you consider this for a minute. The government fails in delivering to the economic aspirations, but with Dr. Swamy's help, gets the Gandhis shown corrupt in the National Herald case and builds the Ram Temple. In such a case where it's a failed economy, success in Ram Temple, how many of you would vote for Narendra Modi? You saw a lot of hands were not up and they were silent. It was vote of the silent. There are a lot of questions that have come from you, Dr. Swamy.
You ask this question in UP and see the reaction.
Age is the same, but
let me add one thing to your point. I have always been of the view that economic achievements do not get you votes.
Of course, Narasimha Rao
have lost. Vajpayee of India Shining advanced the elections by 6 months, lost badly. So did Narasimha Rao lose badly, became half his strength. Morarji Desai lost. I don't know of anyone who has won, and Chandrababu also lost last time here. So I don't know of anyone who has won on the economic plank. If the economic plank is also good, fine. But if you promise people next time you will do the economy, now we have done these two, then I would say the emotions of this country are so high on these issues that particularly where the large number of seats are there, like UP, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, etc., we will get a clean sweep. But we are not doing it because of that. We are doing it because we promised to do it, and we have to do it.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have lots of questions. Some of you have sent questions. I'm really short of time. I'm getting a constant signal from there. Ladies and gentlemen, there will be those people who cannot be described by one word, one phrase, one paragraph. Economist, professor, lawyer, crusader, politician, the man who was Indira Gandhi's enemy, Rajiv Gandhi's friend, and Sonia Gandhi's enemy, and the worst nightmare of Rahul Gandhi, Narendra Modi's friend, Arun Jaitley's enemy, man who wants to abolish. The man who in economics is so liberal, the most prominent anti-Keynesian voice we have in India from a very long time, who speaks about the abolition of income tax, but insists everybody must say, I am a, my ancestor was a Hindu. There is no end to what you can do intellectually by talking to Dr. Subramanian Swamy on a wide variety. I missed on so many questions. Sri Lanka, Maldives, there's so many things I could have asked, but absolute lack of time. Dr. Swamy, you are the favorite child of destiny and controversy. And may, on behalf of everybody, I wish you to continue forever to be the naughty boy, make life miserable for so many people, and a delight for everybody else. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand up for an ovation for this incredible gentleman.
Thank you very much for a warm welcome and your patient hearing, and I hope to be back soon after we win the elections.
Hello. It has been a great privilege and an honor to have Mr. Swamy on the occasion of our annual Pittsman conference and our Techno Management Fest ATMOS. We're also immensely thankful to Mr. Sriram Karri for facilitating such an insightful discussion with Mr. Swamy on such a plethora of topics.
On behalf of Bitsman Society, we would like to thank Bits Embryo and Student Union Council for their continuous support. We would like to thank Lights and Sounds Department, Department of Security and Hospitality, Departments of Visual Effects, Controls, and Department of Photography for their valuable contribution. Thank you.
We will please be seated. We are yet to felicitate our guest. In the same spirit, to express our deep gratitude for being fortunate enough to witness firsthand such great works, I would like to call upon stage our director, Professor G. Sundar, and Associate Dean of Student Welfare Division, Professor Sandeep Deshmukh, along with Mr. Aman Sayed, the President of Student Union, and Mr. Yash Chokhani, the Technical Secretary, Mr. Suraj Chodakura, General Secretary, to felicitate our guest as a token of our appreciation. special thank you to Bits Embryo for co-organizing this talk, for providing us with such a wonderful experience. I would now like to invite Ms. Arushi, President of Bits Embryo, to present a memento to Dr. Subramanian Swamy, and Ms. Sakriti, the Secretary of Bits Embryo, to present a memento to Mr. Sriram Karri as a token of our gratitude. Invite Ms. Varali Chawla and Mr. Shubham Sharma, representatives of Bismin Society, whose efforts and hard work for making this possible is deeply appreciated, to award a small souvenir of remembrance to Dr. Subramanian Swamy. We wish that today's event stand the test of time. What better way to hold testament to today than a painting? Something that will last eternal, a true memorial. To present the portrait of Dr. Subramanian Swamy, I now invite Ms. Mrunal, the artist, onto the stage.
Please stand on your seats, we have a photograph with the speaker.